A very good evening to one and all present here. Welcome to yet another talk in our leadership lecture series. The title for today's talk is Internet of Everything, a new growth opportunity. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Manish Kothari, VP Engineering, Qualcomm India, who's going to talk about his life experiences and how IoT, the current buzzword Internet of Things, constitutes from a business and technical standpoint, and the opportunities and challenges it presents for startups, small and big companies alike. Dr. Manish Kothari is Vice President Engineering, Qualcomm India, where he leads the connectivity, modem, power / architecture teams. Manish began his career at Qualcomm as Director Engineering in 2004, having held various positions at Qualcomm, including leading engineering and business operations in Bay Area. He moved to India in 2013 to lead the connectivity / modem software team. Manish holds a BTech degree from IIT Madras, in addition to a MS and PhD degree from MIT. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming home Dr. Manish Kothari. I would now like to call him up on the stage and address our curious audience.
Hear me? Yeah. Thank you for the intro and distinguished faculty and students here. I'm really excited to be here at IIT, my alma mater, to have an opportunity and talk to you about on the Internet of Things, what's going on, and again. This is colored with a view of Qualcomm. Think of it as a lens, so it's a Qualcomm-centric view, because that's kind of the place I've spent a lot of time about. So before I go into that, I have to kind of flash this kind of as a safe harbor, which is basically Qualcomm is a public company, so if you invest or buy or sell the stock, you're on your own. That's really roughly what it means. Because there will be some forward-looking stuff that I talk about, so I have to always flash this. So if you think about, I'll walk through a little bit of what Qualcomm is, background. I think it's important to understand this. And I think, so Qualcomm is a company that was born mobile. And I think it's very important to understand that, right? It's kind of like, if you look at, certainly my kids, I can say they're born social or they're born in a social network kind of environment. They're very different. So you have to understand the way they think. So when Qualcomm, it was completely born mobile, so the way we look at problems, the way we attack solutions is really from that angle. And so for example, what does born mobile mean? It's like power is central. You really don't have infinite power to do things, right? There's a finite battery, there's a finite weight and a finite profile in which things have to fit in. So that's really very important kind of point. And again, these are some just statistics of 30 plus years of kind of wireless experience. We're kind of number one in semiconductors, 15 billion plus cumulative ASIC shipments so far. And if you look at, I think what is really interesting is kind of mobile is probably the world's largest technology platform. And I think, if you look at number of cellular subscribers that are today, or let me give you a few, couple of years from now, various research companies predict about 9 billion cellular subscribers, and the world population today is in the neighborhood of 7 point some X billion people. So there are more subscribers than people. In a lot of countries, actually, people have better access to mobile than to health or water or electricity, right? It's kind of like, your essential. We used to talk about food, shelter, and, I forget another one, but this is probably the fourth one. You cannot live without your phone. So it's a very important and a powerful technology platform and spans variety of industries. That's what is very unique about it, right? It's not just no longer your cell phone that does a call, right? It's about data, it's about your health, it's about marketing. Interestingly, large amount of marketing is done now through mobile, right? Through likes of Facebook, Twitter, these are all, LinkedIn, for example, these are all moving to mobile platforms, energy, computing, right? You basically have now a 2.x, gigahertz octa-core processor in your pocket, okay? When you think about what that means in terms of computing power, that's pretty phenomenal, actually, where the industry has come and how far Moore's law continues to kind of take us. So this is really a very important kind of viewpoint to say, look, what has happened. Now, one of the things, this is a diagram I used to use, probably in 2004, and what he used to say, look, this is a vision of smartphone, guys. You know, smartphone is a phone call, this razor-looking flip phone thing. But look, you know, in a few years from now, your camera will go away. In a few years from now, your camcorder as a device, it won't go away, don't get me wrong. But really, from a standpoint of integration is coming, right? This was the picture I have used, you know, 10 years ago to say, look, MP3 players, separate iPod, MP3 player, they will go away. Because smartphone is so powerful that you're going to integrate and kind of do that. But guess what? It has occurred, right? I mean, convergence has occurred, right? You can watch TV on your smartphone. You can record movies. You can, you know, you can take photographs for all purposes. You can do a lot of computing stuff. So things have come. So this Internet of Things, as we talk about, right, really has come. Now, they all kind of moved into the smartphone. But the idea is a lot of the devices, there are two things. One is you don't want to carry a multitude of devices, so that is convergence. Second, what brought interesting things by moving them into the phone, for example, a camera, is the ability to upload the pictures, the connectivity that it brings with it, right? So if you think about, you know, our vision from a Qualcomm perspective was to say, look, we're going to integrate things and stuff like that, and that really meant it also not only integrates so it's easier to carry in your pocket, but also the fact that this things, this function becomes connected. Your camera is connected. Your camcorder is connected. Your TV is connected. That's really important, right? So the idea is you can watch TV on demand on your thing. So that's really kind of what we used to talk about. GPS device, I think long ago, 7 or 8 years ago, you know, you used to carry garments of the world. You know, nobody, majority of the people now really use your smartphones for navigation, right? So that is another class of devices that just got disrupted by the fact that you know, the smartphone has here. When you look at what various analysts predict, about, you know, 25 billion to 50 billion, the number is pretty crazy in terms of connected devices by 2020, right? People talk about home appliances. I'm not sure. See, I think one of the other things that we have to think about as engineers, as innovators, as scientists is what problems are we trying to solve, right? That's the number one thing, whether you're a scientist or a businessman, right? You have to first focus on, I know we all like to work on cool things, you know, but it's at the end of the day, it has to bring in some amount of change, whether it's through monetary means or a social means, right? So it has to be related to a problem that's trying to solve. It's not clear what problem you solve by connecting a refrigerator to your, you know, to a network. Possibly maintenance, but things last along. So there's a lot of things that goes on when you hear the world that everything will be connected. It's not clear what problem you're trying to solve. Just because you can connect everything doesn't mean it makes sense to make it connected, right? Security cameras absolutely make sense, right? I mean, you want it to be connected. You want to be able to monitor your security cameras from anywhere in the world, right? So there are some real clear things in terms of lights makes sense. And I think when you look at what is happening today, and this is not very futuristic. There are startups in Bay Area that are working on a BLE-based technology with your lights that the whole idea is the lights and the sounds will follow you. And what I mean by that, you enter your home, your lights are all connected, let's say via BLE, you know, Bluetooth low energy is kind of one protocol. They follow you, they know you are here, and they turn on. And the moment you go off, it turns off, right? It adds value. What? It saves energy, right? That's the key value proposition. The problem you're trying to solve is value prop, you know, that. There's also Bluetooth sound, the whole idea that, okay, you're listening to music in your living room, and you kind of walk off to your bedroom, the sound just follows you, the speakers kind of know, right? Again, some of this sounds futuristic, but there is some problem. You know, now we could question, okay, is this really a problem in a country like ours in India? But in US, you know, it's a problem that's worth solving. People will pay money because they, you know, they do want this to happen. So there's a lot of things that are getting connected, but where the innovation really is what problem are you trying to solve, right? So that's really kind of the key thing. It's not just a technology solution to say, look, you know, I can connect this thing, but what are you trying to solve? What value does a customer or, you know, kind of bring about this? So if you think about, you know, this whole odds of 75% of the 18 to 24-year-olds, this is a very interesting statistic, you know, reach out for smartphone immediately after waking up. There's another statistics that, you know, when I was in US a month ago that had come out that was saying that teens, you know, the kids in their teens check their social network, let's say Facebook, 100 times a day. So it's a pretty... Again, I'm not saying it's good or bad. Everything has a, you know, again, my generation is, you know, I'm at a different generation. So, you know, but the reality is, you know, you are connected. You expect to be connected all the time. And there's a huge amount of data growth coming from video, right? We are, you know, if you look at how this thing is exploding, and I think if those of us who are on Facebook can just see the amount of video content that starts to come on your Facebook, right? Pages are live, actually, they start showing video as you get there, right? So it's a very richer experience. You are going to see a lot of video. From a Qualcomm perspective, it's good, right? Because it makes the problem harder. Now what you have to do is really pump in 1,000x data, not only from the video content, but all these 25 billion devices that are all going to be connected and transmitting some amount of data, right? So it's a very, you know, this thing, this trend has begun. And I think I will talk about, you know, things which are also occurring, you know, in the things, it's not just appliances, but I would talk about buildings, okay? Electric meters, light bulbs, you know, I've talked about, but traffic signals. So you are going to see, and I'm going to talk about some of the futuristic stuff that is actually going on, that Qualcomm is also participating, that sounds a little bit like Star Trek, but it's coming. This is another thing which is saying that, look, IoT is not just about consumer, it's not just about lights, but a huge part of IoT is also industrial, right? If you think about industrial, medical, and I think one example would be, I mean, a lot of kind of machines in terms of, you know, making sure that they self-diagnose, you know, they're able to kind of call the maintenance person on their own, you know, to some extent, initiate certain troubleshoot, you know, programs on their own, some minor repair correction on their own. That's a very big market, right? Because the cost of field service deployment is very huge. So industrial IoT, when it comes to utilities, a very simple one is, you know, somebody coming to your home, you know, reading your electric meter once in a month, right? I mean, that's a very inefficient way of doing things, right? So that's a very simple example of kind of an industrial IoT, so to speak. But there are several others. So it's as engineer scientists, you know, don't think of IoT only as, you know, what you see in consumer or retail kind of environment. Industrial IoT is a very, very big market, machine to machine, that we are actually very actively engaged in as well. So clearly, you know, as I said, smartphone is the most powerful device. 79% of us watch the videos on smartphones. I give you various statistics. You know, this is really alarming. You wake up. I also actually fall into this, unfortunately. But yeah, this is true. I do look for my smartphone when I get up. So this is really kind of here, right? So this is what the scenario is. So now what we have to think about is, how do you kind of go from here? How do you extend this, right? How do you extend this now that smartphone is here, right? This really provides you to kind of extend. So if you look at things that are occurring, wearables, right? Apple Watch is a great example. Fitbit, for those of you, you know, who are into fitness, that's a great example of wearables. Smart home, in and around the home, security is one. Smart cities is a big buzzword that people talk about. You know, I'll give you some examples of what are occurring there. So the smartphone technology is just pervading. So when you look at wearables, a lot of the stuff that's in wearables is really kind of an extension of the smartphone, right? You have connectivity, you have processing, you could have multimedia, you could have sensors. So you can break down the functions, right, into various blocks. And none of these things actually exist in smartphones, right? But the way you apply and where you integrate them into each one of them is different, right? For example, in a wearable, you just cannot have a wearable that has to charge every 2 hours, right? You're not going to wear a, right? It has to last at least a day, if not, some people will say a month, you know, so it just kind of varies. You know, Apple Watch just lasts a day, so you have to charge it every day. Now, that's a life-changing habit, right? Would you replace your watch with an Apple Watch that you have to take out every day and charge? Don't know, right? So I think you have to kind of look at the blocks are similar, but the way you integrate them is very different. So when you, our view from a standpoint of wearables is really more about extending what we call as digital sixth sense. And I think it's just a buzzword, but I think fundamentally all it means is that, you know, you got something in your pocket. Now, how else can you learn about your environment and stuff around you, right? If you have sensors, you can kind of look at that. You can look at GPS. You can have hearing aid, right? You can have a short range to cellular. You can have augmented reality. It's really extending your senses, right? So when you look at, that's really what it's all about. And how it adds value, I think people are still, as I said, what problem is it trying to solve? People are still trying to figure that out. Fitness, tracking is one problem that you're trying to solve, right? Being conscious about how many calories you're intaking, you know, how much are you burning, is an important problem to solve. One could argue. So this is our view is really kind of extending this. This becomes the wearables becomes an extension of your smartphone. It's sensing the environment around you and being able to, you know, give you a little bit more intelligence of how to interact and what to do, right? A lot of this thing is not solved. I'm pretty sure the next 4 to 5 years, you know, technology is always nonlinear, right? Normally we expect it's very slow, but the pace of innovation is very nonlinear. So it's very likely that in 4 or 5 years, this could get mainstream, or it could just go, you know, go kaput. So the projection, you know, projections are, you know, what I've learned is are very inaccurate, actually, when you look at a lot of the projections, again, because of the hockey stick nature. But the projections are about 200 million wearable devices in 2018. That's a pretty big number, right? 200 million wearable devices. So they're all, as I said, they're not all in the same, right? I mean, they do different things. There is fitness tracking. There is healthcare and medical, you know, which does monitoring of your, you know, blood pressure and a lot more of your vitals, which are designed custom to a particular, you know, class of patients, for example. There's a lot of companies out there who are doing very, very specific kinds of wearables and devices to address certain kind of problem market and to solve a certain kind of problem, right? So this is kind of what I, you know, kind of talked about, right? Smartwatches, activity trackers, you've got healthcare. Smartwatch, what I mean is just a mini cell phone, a mini smartphone on your phone, really. You could just quickly check your text, you could quickly check your email, or quickly check the weather, right? So it's just kind of a smartwatch. But activity tracking, healthcare, you know, this whole Google Glass, right? I mean, I think, I'm hoping most of you guys are kind of familiar with that kind of concept. Smarter homes, I think the best way to think about, you know, smarter homes is, you know, as I talked about, home security is kind of a great kind of a use case, right? Lighting, energy, these are great use cases. They're very real. They are happening in a big way. And, if you look at, you know, being green, it's also about saving energy, right? Not just using green energy, but if you can just save. So I think that there's definitely a problem to be solved here. So this is kind of what it is. When you look at, you know, Internet of Things and the connected smart home, at least in US, is already here, right? You've got a home gateway that, again, Qualcomm plays away, where you have a processor. You have a variety of devices that are connected by a variety of means. Another thing that is very important is it isn't that one technology, at least from a connectivity standpoint, is going to work for everybody, right? It's not like 5G is going to, you know, 4G is going to work for everything. In certain scenarios, 2G may be good enough. In certain scenarios, Wi-Fi may be good enough. Certain scenarios, you may want to just use Bluetooth, right? In certain scenarios, you want to use NFC, right? So you have to be kind of technology agnostic, at least from a Qualcomm standpoint. And from an end user, he doesn't care. He doesn't even know what a Wi-Fi, you know, I mean, maybe people know what Wi-Fi is, but people probably don't even know what an LTE is or what 4G is or 3G. They don't care, right? Frankly, they want to make sure that their experience is seamless. So I think that's really kind of what we kind of work up, we look at. So smart cities is another kind of a big kind of initiative. I know it's a big buzzword in India as well. I'll give you some things that are occurring, and these are pretty real and actually in pilot stages in US. So, you know, one of the things that people are looking at is kind of build and become a platform. And what I mean is by, you know, as you walk by a certain building, you know, how can that building interact with you, right? Now, I'm not going to talk about the social implications or, you know, personal privacy and all of that, which are absolutely challenges that one needs to work through. Security, privacy, these are real challenges. Actually, one of the big things that about IoT actually, in my opinion, is about security and privacy, right? I mean, with Facebook and others, if you're not careful, the amount of stuff, your personal stuff that's out there, is just going to get multiplied by this IoT, right? Your home security device is on the internet. Okay, somebody could look at your home if they can hack into it, right? You have a wearable, somebody could hack into your medical device and kind of understand what your health situation is. So I think security is really probably the number one thing, you know, that we worry about in Qualcomm when we deal with this kind of market, right? How do we make sure that we keep the data secure and the privacy things are really well assured, because that's really one of the big dangers actually of this market. You look at smart parking meters in garages. I'm going to talk about that. Road sensors, smart traffic signals. I think these are already there, right? Depending on the kind of the flow of traffic, you know, you modulate that. There are traffic meters that actually learn. I'm going to talk about a concept of a social network of cars. Again, it sounds weird, but it's very real. And there is value to it, because there's a lot of things you learn by crowdsourcing, right? Because things are very dynamic, data is very big, right? So if you're able to learn from a large pool of information, you can actually derive and deduce better information to make decisions. So smart traffic lights is not just about what is occurring at your traffic light. It's also about communicating with the next one to make sure traffic flows smoothly. And so there's a lot of, if you think about the amount of algorithms and stuff that has to go with it, it's pretty interesting. Vehicle charging, that's going to be a big part of. So Qualcomm has a big effort in wireless charging through a Halo, and also on cell phones, right? So when you look at automobiles like Tesla, completely electric, there's a huge talk about kind of building highways that have electric charging underneath them. Okay, again, it's futuristic, but those are the kind of things we will need to solve if you want to make electric vehicles displace IC engine or diesel, petrol, gasoline cars. So this cars are definitely probably after mobile. If you think about the next class of a platform, I think where you can deliver services and all is car, right? So it's another area where we are seeing a lot of innovation now. Cars, things take a long time to get into cars because their cycles are long from a development standpoint. But I'll give you some examples of things that clearly we dream about, and some of this others also dream about. So I think one of the things that you will see, this cloud-connected, self-aware social network of cars will happen. If you look at Google Maps today, a lot of the mapping, when you look at live traffic conditions and the stuff they do, is based on crowdsourcing also. They have sensors, they have people tweeting that, okay, this thing is blocked. All of that thing goes in and they kind of go figure out. If you look at what cars can do today, by the way, lane change warning exists. This is not new. You can buy cars today that will keep you in your lane, right? That exists. There, you can buy cars today that can, pretty much detect the lane and tell you, look, this is ahead, and this car is stopping. I want to stop now, right? Because it's got vision processing, it's got radars, it's got everything. It'll tell you when to exit. There's also self-driving cars there. So I think this whole reality of being able to use that information, again, helps you in saving energy, right? Because the less, helps saving deaths, right? I mean, if you look at accidents occur in these kinds of scenarios. So really, the idea is not just for a machine to take over your car because it's cool, because it does help you in certain scenarios, right? Machines can actually drive you better in a stop-and-go scenario, right? More better than humans. They can react faster with their sensor, right? So in certain conditions, it makes sense to kind of give control. So there's a lot of this whole talk about self-driving vehicle, and there's a whole talk in US about how to now build laws to deal with cars that will be self-driven, right? What can you actually permit? So it's not some far-fetched light. This is occurring today, right? So it's a matter of time where the cars start talking to each other, right? Again, it becomes security, right? It's very important how to keep this thing secure. But it's important because it keeps you safe. Right? It keeps the traffic moving. So you can see and visualize why doing this makes sense. And you obviously have certain cons with it that you have to work through. But having the cars interact will help you flow traffic better, save lives, prevent accidents. Right? So that's kind of what it is. And I think when you look at what goes in a car in infotainment, I think one of the things, I remember my kid telling me, we had a car with a screen. And he was like, why is it not working like a smartphone? It has got a touch. So it's kind of like any screen that, you see, you want it to behave like a smartphone. It needs to interact the same way. It needs to download the same way. Cars are no different. And I think it's a great platform to do, again, what is the con? Safety. You cannot have your driver be distracted by all the stuff that is occurring and kind of focus away from the fundamental use of the car, which is driving. Again, to augment that, you've got all this self, you know, driverless stuff that is coming in. But this is occurring, guys. None of this thing is new to you. But in terms of technology, graphics, multimedia, navigation, this is all smartphone stuff. Nothing, you know, the form factor is different. I don't have a constraint of a, you know, 2000 milliampere battery. I do have if I want to be green, but I don't have the constraint of a battery size. So I can do certain things more, you know, I've got more options to kind of optimize my solution. So that's really kind of what is occurring on the car side, right? And if you look at all the latest technologies are being applied, you know, wireless charging for electric vehicles and hybrids alike, power management, RF, all these technologies, when you look at, are actually being packed in your car today. There's a DSP for doing audio, video stuff. So it's a pretty, but the fundamental guts, you know, the fundamental guts of it have come from a smartphone, right? So smartphone was a platform, now you've got cars, right? It could be buildings, it could be infrastructure. So we'll, you know, you want to think about it as a platform, as a technology platform, and then you can have multiple services that you can offer around it. That's the way at least we think about it. So these are all the various things, you know, I'm not going to bore you with, you know, all the Qualcomm stuff. So this is certainly, you know, to me a very exciting thing because, you know, there's a company called, you can look it up, called StreetLane. StreetLane basically makes smart parking meters. So this is a study done by UCLA, which showed in US, people spend about 1 million miles finding a parking spot. So you're driving 1 million miles more than what you need to. So that translates to, I don't know, you know, some 100,000 tons of CO2 or whatever. Right, so it's a large amount of time that is spent. So they've come up with, they're piloting this in San Francisco, and I've seen their system work. And a lot of the parking meters have technology, you know, connectivity and stuff installed. And so they actually communicate with your car, and they tell you, they advertise, look, I've got a free parking spot here. And then you can just say, look, I can, you can reserve it, or you can say, look, I'm coming there. Right? So you can see the value it brings. Obviously, cuts down you know, quite a bit of driving, and it saves a lot of traffic also, right? Because you've got this 1 million miles being driven just to find a parking, right? So that's really, so this is something that is real, and actually there's a company called StreetLane, there's a couple more in the US that are working on these kinds of problems. But again, I think in Indian situation, things are different, I think, but we have a problem of parking, which is different. We have a problem of a driverless car, which is very different. I mean, if you have to build a driverless car here, you have to be able to recognize, you know, buffaloes, deers, to cyclists, to bicyclists, to people. So I think the processing power will have to be more. The number of sensors may have to be more. The reaction time may have to be a lot more. But again, the problem still remains, right? I mean, I think if you're able to figure this out and you have a right algorithm, maybe you can make the traffic flow better. And I think this is something for India. It's extremely important because if you look at the pace at which urbanization is occurring, right? You could say that in a one way, it's good that the number of car sales are nowhere close to US, because if they were, God only knows what kind of, you know, problems we may face, because the infrastructure doesn't keep up. So I think technology, we can use technology to solve some of these problems, and I think that's really kind of what the point is. And again, you know, wireless charging, this is occurring, right? You can go into spots, parking spots there. Actually, Tesla is playing a big role. You go in, and there are parking spots, and then it charges, right? It charges your car, you're kind of done with it. The range of the electric vehicles today are about 400 miles, between 250 to 400 miles. So multiply that by 1.6. That's a pretty sizable range, actually. The only reason why they're not main scale is cost, the cost of batteries, right? Battery energy density, I was telling somebody, battery energy density actually follows a Moore law, except that it doubles every 18 years, not 18 months. So you know, if you look at the amount of batteries they've got, the cost is huge. And that's why they're building batteries to sell into solar and other things to kind of drive down the cost with volume. But from a technology standpoint, it's here. There's nothing, it's really, the cost point hits where it's, you know, the cost of switching to an electric engine, electric vehicle is there, it will happen. And I think that's pretty exciting, actually, to kind of get rid of, you know, kind of gasoline-based cars to more electrical and greener vehicle. As you increase the vehicle density, you know, where 1 billion people in India start having, or 1.2, I guess, start having 30, 40% of them start having cars. I mean, that's a huge problem, actually. So we better get very fast to a cost competitive electric vehicle than a diesel. It'd just be really very bad air. I mean, Delhi is a great example of what's occurring right now, right? So the other thing you have to think about that we think about, obviously, because, you know, I mean, we are not, you know, we are for-profit company, is what is a business model? And I think this is something that I, again, you know, there are two things, right? One is, what problem are you trying to solve? That's one thing. So you know that, okay, there is somebody who values that. Second is, what is the business model? How do you plan to monetize it? That's also extremely important, because you may have a very good technology, very good, but, you know, you may not be able to sell it because the model is different. What I mean by that is, I'll talk about a little bit of that do you want to sell a light bulb that is connected, or do you want to sell a service which allows you to monitor the amount of energy that you're using, so the consumer doesn't pay for the light bulb but pays, you know, 10 rupees a month for the service. So that's the kind of stuff you need to think about, right? If you, those of you thinking about being an entrepreneur or in this area, in IoT in especially, you have to think about the business model very carefully. Now, we are a semiconductor player, right? We are a silicon ecosystem. But if you think about how the product kind of moves, right? We sell our silicon to device OEMs like Apple and all of that. And then there's a whole consumer ecosystem that controls a lot of the data, right? So people talk about IoT being $1 trillion opportunity, a big number. But it's not clear which one of these are going to take a large amount of the dollars. That's something we have to think about, right? Apple and Google control a lot of your consumer ecosystem. And what I mean by that is, they have access to a lot of the data. They have an access to a lot of the stuff you're doing. Good or bad, I'm not saying. If you browse Google Chrome today, you will start seeing ads that you'd be shocked how relevant they have become. So that's the kind of power that will extend to these ecosystems once they start knowing things about you. Right? Now, they want to use it for marketing dollars, but so there are a variety of players. You have to think about your supply chain. So we are here, and we clearly, on the consumer side, my personal view is, you know, Apple and Google, just because of their ecosystem with smartphone, are going to dominate. It'll be hard to displace them to say, look, you know, it shouldn't work with Android. Anything you do has to work with Android or an iPhone. I mean, so they have that information. But if you want to move up the chain, industrial, verticals, utilities, these are great opportunities that we think about, even for big companies like us. So again, you know, the thing about IoE, if you think about, I don't know how many of you guys have had problems trying to connect to a Wi-Fi network, right? Find a network, click it, sometimes enter a password. You know, it doesn't. Now imagine, now you have 20 such devices you have to connect. You cannot do that, right? You cannot have a situation where, okay, this whole authentication mechanism is as complex, I feel, if you talk to a layman, at least if you talk to my mom, she'll tell you connecting to Wi-Fi is very, very difficult. I don't know. I mean, sometimes it does. I enter the password. You know, I miss a cap. It doesn't connect. Why is it not seamless? Why? I mean, I don't have to connect my cell phone. You know, it's always on. But that becomes a very important part of the problem you need to solve, right? You need to be able to discover autonomously. You need to be able to figure out, who do you want to connect to? Who do you want to talk to? Who do you want to exchange information with securely? Those are very, very important problems to solve. Extremely important. The ease with which, you know, so this is another area where we do a lot of work in terms of, quite a bit of it is software that we work on to make sure that these devices seamlessly integrate, operate, connect, interact with each other, right? Not like every time you have to go and say, look, now let me just connect my home machine. Now let me connect my refrigerator. And by the way, they all have to now talk to each other. It's not going to happen. Right? It just doesn't work that way. So it has to be a very simple way. Somebody bought it, and it's pretty much very easy to kind of get it on the network in a secure way. So it's a very important problem, less so hardware, more so software. Another interesting statistics that I may give you, if you look at the amount of code that goes in a smartphone, and I'm talking about we as a silicon vendor or a, you know, so in about 2008, this is a very important data, and I find it fascinating. It's about 300 million lines of code in 2008. Can somebody just guess what it is today? Somebody want to take a crack at it? Yeah, I think it's about 3 billion. In 5 years, there's a 10x growth in the number of lines of code. 3 billion lines of code run on your smartphone. I'm not counting the stuff that Apple or a Google, you know, all the other stuff that they put on it. Right? 3 billion lines of code are there on your smartphone that has to work very reliably. So I think it's a very interesting kind of software problem for us to kind of make sure that it works reliably, nothing breaks, right? It's secure. So you cannot obviously have 3 billion lines of code in an IoT kind of device, right? It's a very cheap, you want to sell your sensor for 10 cents. The point I'm trying to make is you have to, there's a lot of things that need to occur to make this happen. And I think this is key part, secure. And I think if you want to innovate, this is really an important area to figure out. How do you make sure you keep this data secure? Right? That's really a clear and present danger, actually. So clearly, if you look at recipe for success, connectivity, sensors, interoperability, it's an ecosystem play. So that's really how IoT is going to kind of go evolve into, right? If you build a certain device that doesn't interoperate with something else, then by definition, you're not Internet of Things. You're just connected on your own, right? So if you're out there building a light bulb that doesn't talk with other light bulbs or doesn't talk with other devices, it really doesn't work, right? It doesn't. So it's really a very different, it's an ecosystem play. You have to work with each other. So there's a lot of discussion on, I'm going to skip all these, connectivity in various forms, but so this is another interesting thing that is occurring, right, in terms of sensor integration. A lot of work going on here. It's a very, very active area of research and innovation in trying to figure out, and again, I'm not saying every sensor has to go in a smartphone or a device. You know, a particular application needs a certain kinds of sensors. So there's a lot of work on how to miniaturize it, how to make it power sensitive, how to make it low cost. So there's a lot of stuff that has already occurred. These are the kinds of sensors that are already available today. Fingerprint, already there. You can bet a chemical sensor, you can get an accelerometer. There's special phones that are made to detect pollen, blood rate monitor, proximity. All these are already there, and there's a lot more kind of coming in terms of what it can do. But the key thing is, guys, it's all about integration, right? You have to integrate. And one of the things that people think about, that in a smartphone, majority of the work is done by CPU, and that's a big misnomer. CPU only makes about 15% of the area of a silicon. The rest of it is, custom DSP, a custom GPU. It's pretty amazing how things have got, you can think of it as software-hardware partitioning, right? GPU, graphics function for a long time, let's say in the early 90s, used to be in software and CPU. You have a dedicated hardware block now called GPU, that also is software-enabled. You can do some software stuff, but that is designed to do graphics stuff, matrix multiplications and stuff like that, hardware, right? So it's really driven by, again, smartphone drove it because of power, right? You really need to do this efficiently. If you do more in software, it's more power hungry. If you do in hardware, it's less, but costs you more. So there's a lot of stuff that goes on to make kind of this integration happen. It's not just the CPU. It's kind of what, I wanted to kind of leave a message. So this, this is another area where Qualcomm is, as I mentioned to you, when you have this multitude of devices, you have to find a way that they talk to each other, right? And I think when you think about what we mean by talking to each other, Qualcomm has its own all-join framework. Others are also kind of thinking about how do I get a light bulb or my sprinkler, or my washing machine to talk to each other, right? And how will they talk, right? And one thought that we have is, you should talk by, you should interact by your APIs. You should not be like, okay, you are, hey, look, somebody comes on the network and say, look, I have a printer API, right? You want to do something with me. So there are various, this is another rich area of innovation in terms of figuring out how you get this multitude of devices to talk, interoperate with each other seamlessly, right? Without having you or me as the user trying to go and make them talk. That's not going to work, right? So we have our own framework or all join. I'm not saying this is the only one, but the reason we have it is because we think this problem has to be solved, right? So this is just our attempt from a Qualcomm viewpoint, but there could be multiple solutions. But you do need a framework, a uniform framework where people come together and say, look, I'm going to stick to this kind of framework. So all these devices, they come, they know what they are, and they're able to interoperate, right? Securely, safely, and do the right thing. So the way to think about is APIs from a software context, right? I've got a printer API, I've got a lighting API, you know, I've got an energy API, and that's one way you advertise, and then, you know, you figure out what you want to do with it. So this is another a very rich area of innovation that is occurring, and will have to be, this problem has to be solved for Internet of Things to be realized, right? And I think it will be solved. I mean, there's enough smart folks around in the world. So this is just kind of what we are doing. So again, I think, you know, as I mentioned, from a Qualcomm perspective, you know, we see this as a very important and a big market. And I think all of you guys should also recognize that after smartphone, this is probably one of the biggest markets out there in terms of connecting a variety of things. But it's a very fragmented market. It's not a simple market like smartphone for the reasons I just described about, right? A vehicle to infrastructure market is very different than utilities. So it's a very, very fragmented kind of market. So that's really what I had. And I think, again, you know, this is just kind of more of the same. And the other thing that I have an India-centric view is, you know, there are two ways you could get IOE, you know, kind of devices kind of come to India, right? One is, okay, a lot of the stuff just happens in the US, leading edge, and then slowly those things find their way to India, right? But the other way that occurs, usually disruption occurs from the bottom, right? You're driven by cost, you're trying to solve problems that are relevant to India, and that probably, if you solve them in India, you know, for example, you could actually monetize them and make them commercially viable even better in the, you know, in the developed markets of the world, because the problems are a lot more challenging and the cost pressure a lot more there. So you could have a lot of things where disruption could occur from the bottom. And I think, you know, when I was at a VLSI conference in Bangalore early this year, there's a lot of companies actually in India, startups, who are looking at, you know, variety of problems, whether they are social, you know, rural related, or some, you know, just retail, consumer related, that are problems that are unique to India, right, and require different kinds of solutions. But the other thing that will need to occur, you know, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the PPA for solar to take off. It was really a service model, power purchase agreement is what it's called. But there was an innovation that occurred. What took the solar off was not just that people suddenly knew how to make solar cells, right? Solar cells is a very, very old technology. What really took it off was the PPA, was to say, look, I don't have to pay anything for a solar cell. To me, it's like another utility company, right? I just say, you come install it, I will pay you 5 cents per kilowatt hour. My headache is gone, you can use my roof. That's essentially what changed and drew, when you look at US, drew this entire solar cell adoption. Obviously, subsidies and all of that helped, right? But subsidies were always there, right? What took off was the business model change to say, look, from a consumer standpoint, I don't have to put $40,000 upfront to put something on my roof. For me, it's like, okay, you put on my roof, I don't care what you do with it. If I have excess power, you sell it somewhere else. But I'm just going to pay you, instead of paying to, you know, PG&E, my utility, I'm just going to pay you. So those kinds of innovations are really important, you know, for an probably more relevant to, you know, startups and small companies, and to some extent to big companies like us as well. So definitely think about business models, because you know, that's also unique. Every sector, a utility will have a different business model than a consumer, right? So you have to think about how you're going to get your stuff out there in the market. So that's really all I had from my view. Yeah, I think if you look at Make in India, I think from a standpoint of, you know, if you look at an IoT, you have to look at various components that make up an IoT. But if you look at the actual semiconductor that is made, there is no fab in India that makes it. That's number one. The semiconductor usually goes on a PCB, for example. That, you know, is made in India. You could kind of do that. But then the stuff around it, depending on the device. But yes, there's a lot of opportunity for Make in India. But I think from a standpoint of, again, my view as a semiconductor, you know, India is very behind compared to the other semiconductor ecosystems like US, China, Taiwan, because it just doesn't take a fab. It takes a lot of support system for all your measurement equipment companies like KLR, Tencor. So it's unfortunate, but the reality is, from a semiconductor ASIC viewpoint, you know, we are quite behind. We're quite behind, and I think it'll require probably some sort of a government push to make it happen. I think, again, that's my view. I could be right or wrong. But yes, I mean, to make it green, I mean, that's really, there's a lot of push in the semiconductor fabs to be green. The certifications, the ISO standards that require you to be green.
Sir, you said that all the devices, they should talk to each other. Sir, can you explain more that what do you mean by like talking to each other? Will it be data transfer or like what kind of thing?
Yeah, I think it really depends on a variety of, you know, kind of applications, right? For example, you know, you have a security camera that could talk to your lights. A security camera could detect that, okay, me as an owner is walking into the house, they recognized me, and they say, look, in this particular door, as I walk in, just turn on the lights. So there's a variety of things by which you probably in a home, you do want to interact. Again, interaction is something that will occur depending on the problem you're trying to solve. But you can think of various scenarios like this where just devices sitting on their own is not as attractive if they don't start talking to each other. So that's just one simple scenario where I talked about a smart kind of light. You know, your sound system kind of talking with your lights, coordinating with your lights. As you move out of your room and you're listening to your music and you went to a neighboring room, lights switched off, music turned on, and it turned on here seamlessly. Right? So these things are real. You have to think about what problems there are. But if you get into a situation where multiple devices are there, you want to be able to talk to each other, right, in a home scenario. So that's really what, you know, will bring out, we believe, will bring out the true power of IoT. Otherwise, just a security camera that's connected, you will have one thing. You will have, you know, but again, if you have, for example, multiple devices connected on the grid, if they talk to say, look, I'm at my peak load, can you not consume as much power? There's a lot of scenarios where you can look at. I talked about cars trying to talk to each other. So these are things where you can think about these devices or things, not just communicating to the cloud, but communicating with each other. And what it is, that's an area of innovation, right? That is what we have to figure out. You don't want to talk just for the sake of talking. Maybe we do, right? Just like we want to talk on the Facebook. Maybe things do want to talk to other things, but probably not. But yeah, I think you have to think about what problem they could solve that makes it easier. Crowdsourcing, anything that you want to source information from a crowd or a multitude, you want the ability to talk and interact with each other. But yeah, not everything is figured out. You know, I would agree, not everything needs to talk to each other necessarily, right? And maybe that's one way to control your security, is like, okay, don't talk, right? But maybe inside your home, you do want them to talk, you know, so it's definitely open. Yeah.
So you talked about Aljoin framework, right? So what are the other standardization efforts happening, right, to kind of, because this is like, if everyone comes up with their own framework, right, so they're not going to work with each other. Is there any standardization efforts?
Yeah, there is. You know, IEEE is talking about it. You know, we as Qualcomm are very actively engaged. That's the reason we picked up, you know, because we saw that there was not as much momentum to kind of go do this. Because the market was just kind of very nascent. So IEEE is looking at it. I hear, you know, Google is also kind of thinking about it. So, you know, we just couldn't wait. We really said, look, we need to kind of come up with something soon, you know, as a selfish silicon vendor, right? Because what we also want to do is not to have a situation where, you know, only Qualcomm IoT talks with a Qualcomm IoT device, right? We don't want that situation, whether it's any of the competitors for this market to grow, right? If you just think about even a silicon vendor perspective, it shouldn't matter whether you buy a Qualcomm device or a company X device. They all need to be able to talk to each other. So that's what propelled us to kind of go take that again, because we are an industry leader in, you know, in the markets we are. You know, sometimes you need the leadership to kind of go propel that. So our attempt to go after Aljoin was one attempt to say, look, we want to push this really hard and put the Qualcomm weight around it. So there is quite a bit of players now in the Aljoin alliance. Now, is this the one that will prevail? I don't know, but I hope there's something that we all as a community pick and stick with. a lot of the debate is really around security. I'll tell you, it's a very, very tough problem to deal with. How do you keep these things secure? I mean, we can't keep our PCs secure. We can't keep our smartphones secure. Wait till your smartphones become, start getting hacked. It's very, very, it's a very clear and present danger, you know, that we deal with even on smartphone today, actually, how to encrypt and make sure data doesn't go. So it's a very, very rich area to innovate and come up with a solution that works. But I think there is not a lot of momentum that you see, but Google now putting its weight. I believe when you get 4 or 5 big industry leaders coming together and putting their weight, it will occur. So I'm pretty confident it'll occur, like we've seen in Wi-Fi. Standards come, right? Otherwise, cellular would be a mess. So it will occur. So our effort on AllJoin is just one way to push and galvanize that, really.
What sort of communication is required? GSM, GPRS, or internet protocol?
It's again, I think from a technology perspective, it really depends on the application. So, you have to think about, what is the cost in which it needs to fit in? What is the power characteristics? What is the function? For example, when you look at shoes that you can buy today, whether from Nike, these are all based on BLE, low energy, very low power, so that you don't have to charge your shoes. I mean, they last a long time. And they just transport the data. So probably Bluetooth is good enough. In certain cases, you may have Wi-Fi. In certain cases, you have Zigbee. So I'm not even talking about cellular right now. So you can see that the variety of radio protocols exist today. Security, Zigbee has been a very popular standard, for a long time. So I don't know whether there's one technology that fits all. There will never be. There will never be one thing that fits all. So there will be multitude of technologies. So that's another interesting point that I want to kind of bring out, is all these things have to, from a user standpoint, it doesn't matter whether you're in a BLE or a Wi-Fi or a Zigbee. At the end of the day, what I'm looking for from a data and everything should work seamlessly. But from a product perspective, you really have a lot of options. In some cases, it's NFC. And why you have all these protocols is for a reason. It's for power. BLE is designed for low data rate. So it's very power efficient. So quite a bit of the variables use BLE. Main reason, so you don't have to charge it too frequently.
Is there any restrictions based on the distance?
Yes, all these technologies have certain range. So when you look at power, I would kind of equate that to range, for example. Yes, so BLE has a lower range than a BT, than a Wi-Fi. So that's kind of part of the thing, right? If you're, very simple rule of thumb is if you consume more power, your range is higher, roughly zeroth order. That's absolutely true. So range also matters. That's a very important point, right? If you expect a larger range, maybe even Bluetooth may not work. You may have to go to Wi-Fi. But even if you need a much larger range, maybe you have to go to cellular. Right? In certain cases, maybe you want to go cellular so that you're not dependent on your home network going down. So you may have both Wi-Fi and cellular. For example, on security cameras, a lot of the good ones involve have both. In a scenario where somebody cuts down your, cuts down your home internet kind of gateway access, you don't want the data to kind of not come. So they also have cellular backup. So it really depends on, it's a very, very custom designed stuff.
No longer keeping in pace with Moore's law. And that it's sort of slowing down. And then there's also been research that's developing other materials and so on, like graphene. So I sort of wanted to hear straight from the horse's mouth as to what is the future in terms of chips, semiconductor chips themselves, whether it's, are you still going to continue with silicon or what's the future looking like there?
Yeah, so I think it's a good question. And I think if you look at, from a standpoint of Moore's law, it's still holding. If you look at, probably next year, you're going to have a 10 nanometer process chips commercially available. 14 nanometer will be available by end of the year, or probably actually are available very close to now. So if you look at where we are, 10 nanometer, sub 10 nanometer, you're getting very close to interatomic spacing distances. So there's a lot of work going on. People are talking about 3D, right? Really good kind of growing kind of on top of each other. So At what point would Moore's law stop working? I don't know. We all always wonder that, you know, this is it, probably, why would you need it? And, you know, you get really fooled. But I think the costs are getting astronomically high now. So you're getting to a point where the price to double your speed is really, is going up non-linearly. So it's not that easy to say, look, I'm going to switch to the next big one. You may, but only customers like Apple may be willing to pay for it. But that may not be enough to fill your fab. So there are some interesting things that we have to worry about. But from a computing standpoint and number of transistors per square area or per square millimeter, whatever you want to do, you know, doubling every 18 months, I think for the next 2 to 3 years, there's a clear roadmap. Beyond that, you know, there is a lot of stuff occurring in the literature. So I think it will stretch, but whether the cost equation will be still that people will want to double it, we don't know. For research, you may get to a point where in research or some niche application, people may do it, but it may not be mainstream because it may be prohibitively expensive to kind of do it, right? A lot of the IoT stuff doesn't need Moore's law, right? You're not trying to talk about an infinitely complex CPU processor in your sprinkler or your lighting, right? So so a lot of the things that you're looking at in terms of things don't require, you know, to some extent. Some do, maybe home security does to some extent, but others don't. So if the smartphone doesn't drive, I don't have a crystal ball, but if the smartphone market feels that there is not a need to double the number of transistors or your, let's say, your gigahertz every 18 months, it probably won't happen. This market, more so than PCs, is driving the Moore's law because it's the biggest market out there in terms of the amount of devices you're selling annually. So if this market feels that we don't need, then it will go away. As I told you, even today, when you look at CPUs in a smartphone, it's only 15% of the area, right? So if I just offload the CPU of something and build a dedicated hardware, you know, I don't need that much of a compute power. Because all these CPUs burn power. There's so much thermal issues that we have to deal with in a smartphone. It's really mind-boggling. It's another big area of innovation, and I really encourage you guys, you know, distinguished alumni, you know, faculty and students here, to go look at how you can solve thermal issues in a phone. You don't have a fan, you're radiating multiple watts of power, and your phones get really hot. For those of you, just use it for 20 minutes recording. So it's a very, very, and they're getting thin. Everybody wants a thin looking phone, right? At the end of the day, you're fighting physics. So you know, all you can do is turn on things and we get very intelligent. So we're doing certain things, but again, you're right. So I think if you start doubling and you go to 4 gigahertz processor, you know, I'll burn my pocket if I use it. So you may call it 4 gigahertz, but I'll probably be good enough. I mean, it's another thing, right? When you look at Apple sells a 1 gigahertz dual core. Nobody knows about it. Why? Because gigahertz doesn't matter. It's like, is it good enough for your use case? So in a lot of ways, Apple is saying, forget the Moore's law, I don't need it. They're on a dual core, 1.2 gigahertz. We as Qualcomm are chasing 2 gigahertz, you know, because our other OEMs don't really are able to market that. It's not about just gigahertz, it's about graphics, it's about DSPs, it's about other stuff. So I think if smartphone market just gives up, I think there won't be a need to drive it. Not that a technology won't be feasible. I mean, if you look at research, people are looking at a 10-year roadmap of how they can double follow Moore's law, right? I mean, there's 3D stuff going on. You're going to start building 3D structures and pack more. But is there a business need? I don't know. Yes?
So we connected the printers to internet, and now students are able to take printouts with their mobile phones. In India, the economy sharing is important, and communities are organized, and we are working in this area. Can you tell some of your thoughts on community-centric IoT?
See if I can answer that question. So I mean, your question is really about community sharing. And so I think when you look at, I think one example I can talk about is, which is a lot of the things when you look at societies, right? A lot of housing societies or apartment societies, I think there was something that, I'm not an expert in this, so I think I'm just going to give you what I've heard, you know, to be honest. Because I think it'll require for me to think through that. But one thing that I've seen is communities trying to figure out a way where, they, for example, you know, look at solar power, right? When you look at, it's in your clubhouse or it's in some central location, how do you share that? You know, rather than everybody installing kind of everything, you know, could you put it on your electric meters or stuff like that? People were doing a lot of study, but I think it's a very important area in terms of sharing and what you can do with it. You know, I personally haven't, you know, thought on that angle, so I'm not able to kind of give you, you know, more crisp views on that. But yes, I think there is a lot of opportunities of sharing, whether it's energy. I think energy definitely comes to mind. You know, security is another kind of an important one where you can share information, you know, in a secure way. So you can definitely, you know, that's another area to think about that. You know, I certainly don't, you know, have a lot of thoughts I can tell you right now, to be honest.
Sir?
We'll just have time for one more question. That's
all. Sir?
Yeah. Yeah.
There is a lot of research going on wireless optical communication for indoor different devices communicating. So what are your thought about that?
Wireless optical.
Yeah, so different devices will talk optically with each other.
Through an optically connected cable or?
No, just.
Oh yeah, through a kind of infrared or, yeah. You know, yeah. There's a, I mean, again, you know, there is, you know, if you look at your, for example, a simple, kind of a very simple optical thing is like your remote, right? Your kind of a remote kind of talking to it. There's a problem, I think radio, because there's kind of a line of sight kind of thing, right? And I think that's optical usually requires a line of sight. So there are certain things where they are used, like remotes, old remotes. I mean, most of the remotes today actually are based on line of sight, semi-optical kind of system. Yeah. But they're also getting morphed into radio kind of things. And the reason being, again, you know, you don't have the line of sight, the range is bigger. But I think from a technology standpoint, it really doesn't matter. If there's a certain product and a certain application in which the line of sight, pure optical communication works, you will see that, right? But I think mainstream, majority of the applications, I believe, and I could be wrong, would be radio-based. Because just having line of sight, even in your remote, sometimes it's frustrating. You know, it's to say, look, and maybe we're all getting too spoiled, you know, we don't walk. We just want to sit where we are and be able to turn on your TV on. Maybe that's the wrong thing. We should get into optical, so it forces you to walk. But yes, it really depends on the application. So yeah, there's several niche applications that people are looking at where it's purely point-to-point, even backhauls, for example. There was some study on looking at, you know, you can get it to your base station and then when you want to transfer, people have been working on that to just do direct transmission. So, but those are niche. I don't know whether they will get mainstream, again, just because of the inherent limitations, right, that they come with.
Thank you, sir. I would now like to invite our Dean IR, Professor Nagarajan, to present the memento to our esteemed speaker.
Thank you. Thank you.
No, we don't have a copy.
No, I don't have the copy. It's really great. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone, for being such a wonderful audience and giving us your valuable time. I hope every one of you would have learned from his experiences and would have a takeaway.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.